Good morning.
Good morning.
For those of you who don't know me, I am the intern minister here at Abraham Lincoln Unitarian Universalist Congregation. And as surely as we belong to the universe, we belong together. We join here to transcend the isolated self, to reconnect, to know ourselves to be at home, here on earth, under the stars, linked with each other. And for those of you who don't know me, I am the intern minister here, and I graduated from Star King School of Ministry in Berkeley, California. And I'm doing my internship is one of the last things I need to do to become an ordained minister. So this lovely congregation has invited me to be their intern, and I am having a blast with these people. This is one of the funnest congregations I've worked in. And next September, I get to go see the Ministerial Fellowshipping Committee, which means I get to have a 45-minute conversation, and they get to decide whether I get to be a minister. So, 10 years worth of prep, maybe not so much. 45-minute conversation, and I get to be a minister. Today, we're going to talk about the science of happiness. So in 1938, Harvard began a study of 268 undergraduate men. The researchers followed these men for 75 years. Now, this study is unique in that it is one of the longest longitudinal studies ever. And these men allowed the researchers to present their lives in a three-dimensional way in the study's findings. This 75-year study has found that there are two things you need in life to be happy. What are they? We'll talk about that in a minute. So how many times have you heard, "Oh, just get happy"? Or, "If you put your mind to it, you can make yourself happy." Now, I've always wondered about these words of wisdom. Can you really flip a switch and make ourselves happy? We live in a world where at the touch of a button, we can find almost anything we desire. Information is at our fingertips. We just have to search for it. With all of the advances in our world and in science, we know that humans are hardwired for happiness. We want to be happy. Our brains seek out pleasures and wants to find the things that cause pleasure. Our tongues can detect sweetness far faster than anything bitter. We are born to be happy. So I have to ask, are you happy in your life? With where you are right now? And it's perfectly fine if you aren't. I just want you to answer truthfully to yourself. Where you are right now, this second in your life, is it where you want to be? Now think back to 10 years ago. What's changed? Has anything changed? Or are you in a similar place as you were 10 years ago? As I contemplated this, I realized that my physical location is very different, but my circumstances are pretty similar. Candy, my wife, and I were both working and raising kids 10 years ago, and we're still doing that 10 years later. Srikuman Rao gave a TED talk about plugging into our hardwired happiness. And in that talk, he discussed how we are spending our entire life working to be unhappy. I was like, unhappy? I thought we sought out pleasure and happiness naturally. So Rao stated that the model we are taught about life and how to be happy is flawed. That we are buying into a mental model of an if-then world. Rao believes that we don't know that this is the model that we're working in and living in, and we don't know that it's flawed. We believe that we have to get something to be happy. And once we get it, we'll be happy. So, has that worked for you? I could honestly say it hasn't worked for me. A couple of years ago, I desperately wanted a brand new car because all of our cars have, we drive old cars. And I really wanted a brand new car. And I actually remember thinking, if I get that new car, I will be ecstatic. Then I got the new car along with the payment. I was happy to have the car, not happy to have that payment. So in Rao's model, this is the flawed thinking, what he calls our habitual grasping self. So who has ever been in nature and seen something really breathtakingly beautiful? Did the scene fill you with joy, contentment, bliss? When Candy and I got married, we took a cruise to Alaska. And I remember watching out the window, and it was as we sailed past these mammoth icebergs and ice shelves. We went on hikes in Alaska and saw the most spectacular views. I would sigh, and I would feel happiness and joy just sing through my body. During that trip, not once did I think, wow, look at this iceberg. It is so beautiful. But you know, it's a little off-centered. You know, I accepted the universe just as it was, and it was gorgeous. In those 2 weeks, my habitual grasping self went away for a bit, and my innate happiness was present. Even now, a decade after that trip, just the memories of Alaska brings a sense of relaxation and happiness for me. I sigh deeply and remember that utter contentment I felt while we were there. Accepting the world as it was freeing. Rao believes that if you are not accepting the universe as it is, you are buying into the if-then model. Nancy Etcoff is a psychiatrist and a researcher, and she stated that the pursuit of happiness is obligatory. Humans wish to be happy, only wishes to be happy, and cannot wish not to be so. We are wired to pursue happiness, not only to enjoy it, but to want more and more of it. End quote. We work so very hard at being happy, but are we actually happier? In 2016, there are over 120 million prescriptions for antidepressants. If we're trying to be happy, then why are so many of us unhappy? Is this what Rao was talking about our grasping self? When we strive for a thing, a specific outcome, we lose our natural happiness. I remember growing up and being asked by what I swear was every single adult I ever came in contact with what I wanted to be when I grew up. They would ask, "Want to be a lawyer? A doctor? A pilot?" Not one person asked me what made my heart and soul sing. What did I want to do because of love? What did I really enjoy doing? Not one person ever told me it was best to follow my heart when choosing a career and not to follow the money. By asking these questions, we are teaching our children that money is most important, and science is assuring us it is not. We are goal-oriented people living in this world. We focus on the outcome instead of the journey, the process. I want to encourage you to follow your passion, not the money or the outcome. Passion exists inside you, not in the job or the task itself. If you ignite the passion inside you, the universe rearranges itself to accommodate the new you. Everything we do is a journey. So ask yourself, is this the journey that I want to take? Is this how I want to spend my time? If it isn't, we have the power to change our journey. Whether it's baby steps or a full 180, focus on the process, not the outcome. Actions are within our control. Outcomes are not. And we are our own map makers. We live in a society that is deeply, deeply invested in outcomes. The outcome is not in our control. And often, it's the opposite of what we want. When it's all over, and you look in the mirror, can you say that you did your absolute best? Not, did I get the outcome I really wanted? Or did I get the thing that I really was desiring? But did you do the best you could for what you were doing? Did you invest fully in the process? And was there happiness along the path? So, are you curious about the Harvard study? That study found that there are two pillars of happiness. The first one is love. The other is finding a way to cope with life that does not push away love. The study found that meaningful relationships and connections matter a lot. People are happiest when engaged with others. We, as a human species, need to be in a group where we feel we belong, where we have deep, deep, connected, meaningful relationships. Each one of us has chosen this place to be our spiritual home. Our faith believes strongly in the interconnections among us. This is one of the reasons we have chalice circles. These groups allow us to connect with one another much deeper. We get to connect in these groups and in these chalice circles much deeper than we ever can on a Sunday morning by developing our relationships with one another much more fully. We strengthen ourselves and our intentional community. In doing this, we ensure that this is not only our spiritual home, but our happy home. And now we take our leave. Before we gather here again, may each of us bring happiness into another's life. May we each be surprised by the gifts that surround us. May we each of us be enlivened by constant curiosity. And may we remain together in spirit till the hour we meet again.